We started a bit late. We are already late by 15 minutes. There are some yesterday in Bangalore we had heavy rains. There was some power problem. We had some technical snag. As you know, Department of Communication, Bangalore University, we have organized a week-long national webinar on the future of Indian media industry, and it was inaugurated on Monday by our Honorable Deputy Chief Minister of Karnataka, Dr. Ashwath Narayan, and a media expert and eminent film director, Nagabharna, was there. Dr. K. R. Venugopal, the Vice Chancellor of Bangalore University, presided over the function. And we had excellent media professionals to interact with all of us. And today, though this is the first edition of the national webinar, this is the fifth day all of us are meeting. So today we have a very eminent journalist and a film director, N.S. Shankar, with us. I'm very happy that all of you have joined, and every day we received quite a lot of questions, and there was an excellent interaction. Yesterday, Ghoshal from ZTV, he made a presentation on the entertainment and media industry, and earlier it was G.N. Mohan, it was Dr. Asha, a journalist, she spoke on the latest developments of the media industry. And on the first day, we had Professor Biplab from Shantiniketan, Kolkata. He made his presentation. So today, on behalf of all of us, I extend a very warm welcome to N.S. Shankar. And two of my colleagues are with me. Dr. N. Sanjeev Raj, Associate Professor of the Department of Communication. I extend a very warm welcome to Dr. Sanjeev Raj. And again, another colleague, Dr. Shailashri, I also extend a very warm welcome to Dr. Shailashri, Associate Professor, Department of Communication. And I see quite a lot of faces, lot of media professionals, academicians, researchers, and all of them joined us. We are very happy. And maybe there's a very big contingent even from Karnataka. Dear friends, Mr. Shankar will be bilingual. Please bear with us. He will speak in English as well as sometimes if there is a question in Kannada, he will also answer in Kannada. Kindly bear with us. And we are receiving quite a lot of mails and messages through WhatsApp regarding your e-certificate. Please don't worry about e-certificates. All of you will get the e-certificates. And as you know, Department of Communication, Bangalore University, this is one of the pioneer departments in the country. This is one of the top rated media schools, which is recognized at the global level. And we are very happy for the roaring response throughout the globe. So we are very grateful to all of you. I request my colleague, Dr. Shailashri, to extend a welcome address and introduce Mr. N.S. Shankar. Over to Dr. Shailashri.
Thank you, sir. On behalf of Department of Journalism and Mass Communication, I take this privilege of welcoming Sri N.S. Shankar. N.S. Shankar, writer, thinker, and the media expert and the film director. N.S. Shankar was born in Soraba, Shivamogga district. He did his master's in journalism and mass communication from Bangalore University. He started his career as a journalist by working in Tumakuru Times Daily in the year 1979. He then joined Janavani evening newspaper. He gained recognition as an established writer by joining Prajavani newspaper. He has also worked in Lankesh Patrike. He has also worked as an editor in Sudhi Television. He made a short film, Muttisi Kondavaru, based on Lankesh's short story. He gained recognition as a writer, producer, and director in the year 1990. He made four serials for Doordarshan, that is Badhuku Jataka Bandi in the year 1991, Shodha in 1992, Parisara in 1993, and Kshamaya Dharitri in 1994. He has also made more than 100 documentaries, short films, telefilms, and has bagged two state awards and many more awards. By making the film Ulta Palta, he made a debut to Kannada film screen in the year 1997, followed by Wrong Number in 2003, Chutata in 2005. Raithabali, his 23 episodes documentary in Sudhi Television was a phenomenal experiment in the history of television media. He has bagged Karnataka Madhyama Academy Award in the year 2015, Kiram Puraskara in 2017, Press Club Award in 2019 for his 3 decades of service in media. He has written many books, research articles, and some of his books are Chanchala, Chanchale, Maya Bazaar, Avarana, Anavarana, and Poolan Devi, etc. are some of his books. We are privileged to have him today as a resource person. I welcome you, sir. I welcome our chairman, Professor B.K. Ravi, sir, former registrar, Bangalore University, to this webinar. I also welcome my colleague, Dr. N. Sanjeev Raja, Associate Professor and Webinar Convener. I welcome all the academicians, media experts, research scholars, and students for this webinar. Over to you, sir, Dr. Sri N.S. Shankar.
Thank you, Dr. Shaila Sri, and thank you, Dr. B.K. Ravi. Today we are here to discuss the future of Indian journalism. Actually, I was thinking, why not discuss the present of Indian journalism? See, we are passing through a very difficult phase of history. Not only India, the whole world is reeling under the onslaught of this corona phenomenon. Particularly in India, the economy was already in shambles even before corona happened. And now, because of corona, suddenly now millions are left on the streets, migrant workers, stranded on the streets without food, without money in their pockets, without knowing where to go, without any transport. And report says 12.5 crore of people have lost their jobs during this corona. And IMF report says 40 crores of Indian people will slip into very deep penury, that's extreme poverty, as a result of this pandemic. And there are many more problems that are going to afflict us in the coming years. The economy is seeing a negative growth. Expert opinion says that the situation is really, really bad. So what we as media persons do, what can we do, what are we doing? See, these are the questions that I think every one of us should think about. See, first of all, we cannot blame any single person for such a tragedy like corona. But when there are shortcomings or when there are glaring failures on the part of the ruling dispensation, we should be alert to point out the mistakes. We should be able to see, we should be able to say very clearly who is responsible for what. Why did this phenomenon acquire such a gigantic proportions when there was possibilities of handling this situation, handling this crisis very early? Why was not that taken up? See, these are the questions that keep popping up. And on the other hand, we have seen voice of dissent being repressed. Many are jailed without bails. When such is the situation, what does the journalist do? See, Gandhiji said journalism's basic duty is to serve. To serve. People, to tell the people that what is wrong with the system, what are we doing? What are the Indian media doing? I don't know, you are better judges, you should tell me. Anyway, one thing I find basically wrong with Indian journalism is we have always been chasing or moving around the centers of power. We concentrate only on what ministry is doing what, especially when with the arrival of news channels, the definition of journalism has changed. The definition of news has changed. what is news, what constitutes. News, those perceptions have to define journalism. We should do. See, for the sake of TRP, it's very essential to run a channel. For the sake of TRP, we indulge in all kinds of sensationalism, all kinds of falsehoods, and people who are who thinking people, they want to avoid news channels altogether to stay safe and sane. That is what people are saying these days. Avoid. Watching news channels, you will be safe, you will be healthy. What should we do instead? So whenever I get a chance to interact with media students, become a very competent journalist, what do you have to do? Just a second, I tell them that you should understand our society first. We should understand our environment first. The kind of society that we are living in. But Indian society is such a huge and complex society with thousands of castes, thousands of languages, thousands of cultures. How do you comprehend this? How do you set out to understand this? What do you do? Such a huge thing, it needs a lifetime to understand this society. But what do you do? Where do we start? So I suggest to them, I give them a simple, very simple suggestion. You ask yourself two questions. Only two questions. Now India has been independent for the last 73 years. Though we are in an independent nation, starting from 95 up till 2015, in these 20 years, around 3,10,000 farmers have committed suicide in our country. We don't have figures after 2015 because farmers have stopped suicides, because government has stopped giving out statistics. These are National Bureau of Crime Records statistics. This is one. That is 3,10,000 farmers in 20 years have committed suicide, which works out to roughly one suicide per 40 minutes for 20 years. Why? This is the first question. Why? The second question is, again, even after 7 decades of independence, untouchability is still in practice in the country. Why? This is the second question. Why? So you start with these two whys. Why? Why are the farmers committing suicide, and why is untouchability practiced? You will begin to understand Indian society better. You should search for your own answers. You should keep asking yourself. These are not easy questions. You don't have ready answers. You will have to search and search and search and dig. Then you will understand our Indian society. Then you will be in a better position to be a better journalist. So this is one aspect. As an example, we have P. Sainath, Maxse Winner journalist, P. Sainath, who is the champion of rural India. You know of his book, Everybody Loves a Good Drought. See, he has concentrated only on rural distress, farmer suicide, and the issues like this. And he has made a change. I mean, he has brought about a change in the way people look at these things. How much of space goes to rural issues in the newspapers or in channels? He has raised such questions, many such questions, and has made people aware of these issues. But these are the issues we actually should concentrate on, isn't it? But instead, we are concentrating on as X and Y, X, Y, Z, the minister, his affairs, his scandals, even preferably. So instead of chasing these ministers, why don't we chase the social issues that surround us, that make us helpless, make rural population helpless, that make the majority of India helpless? Why don't we look at that? So that is the present situation, and with this present situation, we are moving into an unknown future. See, after all, the present shapes the future that is to come. So if we are handling this kind of present, what kind of future do we expect or can we anticipate? I don't know. So these are the basic points I wanted to make. Dr. Ravi, if you want me to expand on something else, I want you to intervene.
Okay, sir. Okay, basically, you're a senior journalist. I think I have seen you since 1979, whether you remember or not, from your senior one of those. Janavani days, 1979.
Yeah, Janavani days. That was in 1979.
Yeah, when we met, it was in 1979. So, you're a senior journalist. You were part of Prajavani. You were part of Suddhi Sangati. And as a journalist, you have seen the newspaper industry since 70s. Now it is 2020. See, what are the differences you see, and according to you, what is the future of print in India? We want your expert opinion, because you have started from the composing base to you have seen the technology, and you've seen the development as an industry.
Yes.
So as a senior journalist, how do you see the future of print in India?
The print, of course, has its own future. I don't say that print will go away. It will not. Because we will need newspapers, to see, even after watching all the news on channels or way of browsing on my mobile. I still want to read the newspaper the next morning to be sure of what's happening, to know what's happening. The print has retained a lot of credibility in comparison with visual media. So print will stay. It cannot go away. Of course, it has adapted to technology. Its approach has changed. When news channels appeared, print was in sort of very great confusion. They didn't know what to do. And slowly settled down, and now they have devised their own approach. They are making it more user-friendly or youth-friendly. Such changes have happened. In the sentence, you must remember that Karnataka witnessed a series of very meaningful movements, like Dalit movement, farmers' movements, environment movement and feminist movement. All these movements have contributed to the general understanding of what society we are living in. So till then, newspapers were not aware of concepts like social justice. They were only restricted to reporting what some important person says or something. But when they became aware of these social issues, their approach changed. And they became more meaningful, especially leading newspapers like Prajavani. They actually swam with the time, and they have remained in vanguard. So, but print will stay. Print cannot go away, but of course, the readership may shrink, go on shrinking. And in a period like presently, when the corona has, stalled the economy, there are no advertisements for newspapers. They are finding it difficult to run the newspapers. They are retrenching people, cost cutting. All these things are happening, but this is a temporary phase, I presume. I think that print will stay, and they will have to adapt to the new year and new year sensibilities.
Okay. So, according to you, in spite of the decline of circulation and all the developments that is happening in the newspaper industry, according to you, after COVID-19, you think that the newspaper will stay in this country? Because there are a lot of discussions going on.
Perhaps smaller players may go out. Smaller players may not afford to stay, but the bigger players like Indian Express, Times of India, Prajavani, and groups like that, they will definitely stay, I think.
What will happen to the e-newspapers? See, because after COVID-19, it was the newspaper industry which was the worst affected industry, along with cinema and television. But what do you think is the status of e-newspapers? Because when the our distribution boys, I think a lot of them were chased from the flats. They were never allowed to give a copy of a newspaper to a... They were chased away. So it was in a very bad condition, and because the lockdown has brought up quite a lot of developments. So according to you, what will happen to the e-newspapers, or will the newspapers remain in the printed form? Because in the West, I think the circulation and the printed newspapers have disappeared. So what will happen in India?
Newspapers, as I said, newspapers will not disappear in India, but their circulation may shrink. Hmm. On the other hand, of course, this digital medium is picking up, and people are more and more resorting to their own blogs, digital outlets. And newspapers are also doing parallelly, bringing out their own digital versions.
Hmm.
But there is no set new model for digital market as it.
Okay.
So I don't know if it's a newspaper, there is a price, 6 rupees. You pay 6 rupees, get your copy. But what do you do with a digital version? How do you monetize it? How can you get back your money on that? That is still very uncertain. And some in some language, perhaps English may be in a better position, but vernacular languages, languages like Kannada, Malayalam, Tamil, Telugu, Tamil, Malayalam, they can do well, I think. But Kannada is in an inferior position as far as marketing is concerned. And this digital space itself is very fluid as of now. There are not definite contours or, you know, boundaries. It's not defined yet. So we'll have to still explore it, and it will take a lot of time. So, hello?
Yeah.
That's a very fluid and indefinite kind of space that needs time to settle down.
I think in the beginning you made a point that journalism was a field of social service. So after Indian media converting itself as an industry, you said that there's a redefining the concept of news, the priorities, the content of a newspaper. How do you see it? Because you come from the old school. I don't think I will not be wrong if I call you. You come from the old school. So you have said the Indian media. Yeah, most of us, they blame
it. I take it as a compliment. Fine.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
No, because majority of us, whenever we think of, we speak of social responsibility, they tell us, sir, you belong to the old school, sir. You don't know the new concepts. So because since you belong to the old school, how do you look into the redefining of this news, the content and production of the newspapers?
You mean newspaper or other media?
Oh, newspaper. Later on, I'll come to cinema and others later on. We are discussing on the newspapers because you had a very big career in the newspaper industry.
Yeah, print medium is not actually taking very giant leaps as such, like unlike news channels. Print medium has continued to do what it has been doing all along, but only it has taken... a few steps forward. Perhaps they have become a movement to news as such, remains as it was. There's not much difference. Of course, their preference for news depends on whoever is in charge. I mean, the editor or the policy of the newspaper. But by and large, newspapers have been doing what they have all along been doing from the beginning. See, of course, in pre-independence days, it was the independence first. That was the first issue. Freedom. Then after that, it was nation building. It was Nehru's India. So in the 70s and 80s, it changed again. It was a period of protests and, you know, rebellion. And after post-globalization days, of course, market is everything and news has become a commodity. So newspapers have changed, media have changed according to that. So the world of the question of service come in. It is for the individual journalists and, of course, newspapers to decide. See, but the situation is not all that disappointing. Of course, there are many complaints, but overall situation, I think, is acceptable.
in the new trend, a lot of journalists are losing jobs, and in earlier days it used to be security for journalists, and now there is no security for any of our journalists.
Yes.
A suggestion to our young journalists who are dreaming to join the mainstream Indian media industry.
Yeah, that uncertainty is always there. Now, post globalization, nothing is permanent. See, earlier it used to be appointment letters. Now these are contracts. So you are given a particular job for a particular period of time, where you will have to either prove yourself, or the management should decide to keep you, or retain some people out, send some people out, give you a pink slip, so to say. See, that uncertainty is always there. But bright and competent journalists should find sufficient jobs, I think. And there are many alternate media today. So, job-wise, the number of job-wise, the situation is much, much better than earlier. When, see, earlier days, if you are in a particular newspaper, you are sent out or you want to resign, you have no other choice. There are not many choices open to you. You cannot go to, you know, 5 newspapers. There were not 5 newspapers. But today you have a lot of newspapers, lot of media outlets, lot of alternative media outlets. There are many digital platforms which are doing lot of job, lot of good work, like Scroll or Wire, portals like Wire or Scroll. So you have many such outlets. So you can always, if you are really competent, you can always find a suitable platform for you.
Complete.
Yeah, I think the situation is not all that bad. Though it looks prima facie, on the face of it, it looks bad. It's not all that bad.
So you were part of daily newspapers for a very long time, and later on you shifted to the weekly.
Yeah.
How do you look into the reach of these two things? Because you were part of a larger circulated Kannada Daily for so many years, and later on you shifted to weekly. How do you see the reach of these two? Because you were also part of Lankesh. Yes. How do you see the weeklies and the dailies, the reach of these two?
See, dailies, if they are very established, of course, the reach is very, very large and strong. See, that is always there. A weekly will never reach that kind of a circulation. Fine. But a weekly like Lankesh Patrika, where I was working in, it had its own base, and readers were not just readers, they were also fans of Lankesh and the Patrike.
I think there is some technical snag.
Those in power.
Yeah.
They learn to criticize, or they learn to speak up, and they learn to go on the streets and protest. So those things happened because of Lankesh Patrike, and the prevailing atmosphere also, that was also conducive. So, but of course, reach wise, working in a paper like Prajavani has no parallels. Because that's in lakhs, actually people perhaps read in, many, many, many lakhs. So around 50 lakh people read the paper, counting 5 readers per paper. Per copy, around 50 lakhs people should be reading it. That kind of reach you will never have with a weekly. But you will have a different kind of impact. You can always hope to have a different kind of impact. Where you will have your own voice, it becomes your own platform. Prajavani, with all that, it's an anonymous platform. You don't get to, read your own your own name every day, no. But in a weekly, it's your platform, you write opinion also. You can write anything, you can write criticism and be heard.
Okay. The advent of this digital technology and the rampant expansion of television in this country.
Yes.
How do you see the future of magazines?
Magazines are in a very, very difficult position, I think. They will really find it very hard to stay afloat, stay alive. Question of growth does not arise at all. See, they will have to manage. It's very hard to manage. In fact, established weeklies and monthlies in Karnataka are facing difficult situation. It's very hard to keep growing. Magazines, because magazines, in a sort of way, digital platform is becomes an alternative to magazines. So, and it's freely available, and people who are on the digital platforms will not need any magazines unless they particularly want a particular kind of a literary magazine or something like that. The general magazines will find it very difficult to stay.
Don't you think that the reading habits, see, if you just look into the data, the reading habits is gradually coming down.
Yes.
And do you think still the magazine journalism will survive, especially in a country like India?
That's what I'm saying.
Of a magazine, and, it requires a lot of creativity. See, in our days, we used to have what is called the magazines which used to cater to the whole family.
Yes.
70s, 80s, it used to cater to, we used to have sports, politics, economics, children, women, literature, everything.
Yeah, everything.
Gradually, after 80s, we started looking into specialized magazines. Now, the reading habit is gradually coming down. And how do you see the future of magazines in this country?
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. The magazines will find it very hard to survive in the coming days. See, even if you are looking, talking of a specialized magazine, you can always find a specialized website or a specialized portal to match that. So, for magazine, whereas newspapers are not like that. Newspapers will always have a base. But magazines, it's very difficult to say. I don't think any fresh magazines will come up, or the survive existing magazines may not survive for long.
So, you shifted from journalism to film industry.
Yes.
One of the successful film directors of Karnataka, and your films was a box office hit so far as Kannada film industry is concerned. How did you manage, see, from print journalism to film? See, these are two independent medium. The requirements of print is totally different. Now you enter a visual medium. So you became the most popular director. You wrote the screenplay, and I think you also wrote a book on how to write a screenplay also. That's also a
topic. That's one of my recent books.
How did you manage? Because from print to cinema, what were your experiences and how did you manage, and what are the differences of these two media?
See, after a certain period in journalism, print journalism, say after a decade, I thought I was fatigued. I mean, I didn't want this anymore. This is not the thing I want to do. Something, some kind of an unrest, a restlessness started happening. So I wanted to have an alternative thing to do. So it was then that films struck to me that this could be my field, because I have always been a movie buff since the age I remember. And my qualification to be in cinema is that I am a student of literature. So in literature, what you need is to understand people's motives, so why people behave in a particular way. That is the kind of stuff that goes into literature, and that is the same kind of stuff that goes into cinema. Here also you explore the human behavior. So I thought I was equipped to do that, and I started watching films and I started reading about films, and I wanted to venture into films. So it all started with a short film I did for Doordarshan based on a story by Lankesh. And then I began to understand the difficulties and the nonsense of the medium. So I kept on thinking about it. I watched a lot of films, learned from filmmakers. And by trial and error, I went on learning, and I am here today.
Now, how did you manage to produce a very successful film? It's not that easy to hit the box office, because basically you're a journalist. But many people, they produce quite a lot of films, and finally but the beginning itself, you were a box office hit. How did you manage and how did you select the content And did you ever expect that there could be a back office hit?
Yeah, I definitely thought this would be a hit because the content was such. It's based on, as you know, Shakespeare's Comedy of Errors. And that play is an extraordinary play and of course it has its own advantages. But by the time we stepped into films, I had already done the 4 serials and a lot of short films and documentaries. So I was familiar with the craft of filmmaking. What I needed was a very good script, very good content. So we found that content in Shakespeare's play. In fact, even before Shakespeare's play, we had thought of doing something else. A thriller based on Agatha Christie's novel, but then we abandoned it. We took this up. See, comedy always, you know, it always works. It has no expiry date. So even today, people tell me that they watched Ulta Palta just yesterday or day before yesterday when it was telecast on some channel and they find it fresh even today. They find it fresh because comedy is always fresh. It is always refreshing. So our choice of the subject, you know, paid off. It went on to become a very big hit and it saved us. Otherwise, I wouldn't be in the cinema medium so far.
So after COVID-19, we saw the lockdown of the whole industry and even film industry was hit. How do you see the future of film industry in this country?
Film industry, again, you know, it will need time to come back to normal. But once this atmosphere clears, even then people will be afraid to come to theaters for quite some time. But they will definitely watch stars films. Say Darshan film or Puneet Rajkumar film, they will definitely flock to theaters to watch those films. And slowly, I hope people will start coming into theaters to watch more and more films. Now, these days, a film need not get released in a theater but still make some money. There are alternative platforms like OTT platforms, Netflix, Amazon, and alternative ways of marketing a film. So, but it will take time. It will take time. Definitely, it will take time to be normal again.
So as a journalist, can you recall some of the very relevant issues which you reported or anything of that kind? Because this generation, most of us will be discussing about the autonomy of a reporter, the independence of a journalist and all those things. But you were a reporter for a very long time. And do you recall any of the memorable event that happened in your during that days of reporting?
No, such particular events I don't remember, but I remember discussing with my editor Raghuram Shetty when we were bringing out Mungaru. So I was telling him that journalism should be like social science. It's not just journalism as just a career. It should be social science. Social science, I didn't even understand that very clearly in those days. But what I meant was, a social science tries to understand and interpret the main conflicts in the society.
Yeah.
It's not just, you know, journalism does not mean just going to Vidhan Sabha, reporting a speech or reporting a press conference. It is to understand what's happening around us. That's why I quoted P. Sainath. That's what he has been doing. But in those days, we did not have very clear idea of these things, but we tried to explore what it could mean. If you look at the pages of Mungaru, if you happen to see any copy of the Mungaru newspaper, you can find a difference in the kind of topics we covered. There were sociological or such studies also, but reported in a very popular idiom. We did lot of things like that. It was not just regular journalism. Unfortunately, nobody recognized it then because many people did not understand it first. But it went on taking more and more clear shape after my post Mungaru days. I left Mungaru. Mungaru, we had to leave, many of us. We came back, we launched a daily, weekly, Sudhi Sangati. Then after that, I went to Lankesh Patrike. And even now, I continue to write, not to publications, but I continue to write on my own. Socio-cultural criticism is my main area of interest. Even now, I remember that journalism should, be a social science. So that is what guides me in my writing even today.
So after film industry, you joined the television industry.
News channel.
So yes. What were your experience and how do you look into the future of television, especially not only the news channels as well as the entertainment channels?
Yeah, you see, news channels or entertainment channels, they depend basically on ad revenue. They have to have advertisers to back them, support them. Otherwise, they will have to shut shop. Now, I have heard that two or three channels are going to shut down in Karnataka. So, right now, presently, the situation is very bad because there is no revenue. There is hardly any revenue. To get a better atmosphere, it needs time. Until then, these people will have to survive, will have to sustain themselves. Yeah, the market is, the overall economy is in a very bad shape, and it will take perhaps more than a decade to set right. So all these people will face difficulties. Everybody will be on the streets almost, including these channels.
How will you see the ethical concepts when compared to print and the television?
Print is always better. Print has always been better. Even though several newspapers you don't feel like reading at all. They are toilet papers. But by and large, the leading newspapers have retained some kind of ethics at least. But you cannot say the same thing of news channels. They are downright propagandists, spreading falsehoods, beating the drums of somebody whom they like. See, it's very, 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 very deplorable.
How do you see the future of television channels in the future? All over in Indian media industry.
Yeah, that's what I meant. They have difficult times ahead. At least for a decade to come, because their dependence, their health depends on the economy of the country. The economy is in very, very bad shape. This will take a lot of time to recover, to come back to normalcy, at least a decade. So this decade will be a very difficult decade for everybody, not only channels, but also every industry, every job sector, everything. It's a very tough phase.
Do you think this digital media will be parallel to all these media from now on? And how do you see the prospects in the Indian media industry?
They cannot be parallels as long as they are not revenue generating platforms, or as long as they don't expect revenue, they will survive. Because to expect revenue from a digital platform is even more difficult than a news channel or a newspaper. So, but if it is your personal pleasure, you write a blog, you hear your views, you write whatever you feel like, you write a poem, you are happy, readers are happy, fine. But you want a somebody to pay for your pay to pay you and read you, that is difficult because there is no established revenue model as such for digital platforms. That is the difficulty. Even now,
okay, friends, there is some technical snag, and there are Shankar is basically a senior journalist, and I think he was explaining about, because he's a multifaceted personality where he has worked in almost print as well as electronic media, and even the film industry. And he's a very good screenplay writer, a very good director, and he made it. He got a vast experience, especially in media. So basically, starting, because as a journalist starting from the composing era to the digital era, the journey from the past 4 decades, I think he has seen media at different levels. But now it's a fact that all of us are worried about the Indian media industry, and all of us, we know after the entry of television, what were the different developments and what exactly happened. We saw the metamorphosis of Indian media industry, the pre-independent scenario in the 60s and 70s. The profession itself was called a social service. Later on, for the first time, the commercialization happened and we started calling Indian media industry. And we also saw the decline of the theory of social responsibility to some extent. And it is the marketing forces which started dictating, and this total profession became profit and loss calculating profession. All of us know. So under these circumstances, every day we are thinking to work out the future of Indian media industry, because now in this group there are quite a lot of media professionals, quite a lot of academicians, researchers. So all of us are sitting together and discussing quite a lot of things. And since in the beginning of this webinar, I am making a point very, very clear: if the Indian media industry is affected, if the Indian media industry is affected, definitely the education institutions, the field of academia and research and everything will get affected. There is no doubt about it, because unless there is a coordination between the academicians and the industry professionals, media professionals, it will be very difficult both of us to survive. If there are quite a lot of opportunities in the media, definitely people will opt for this subject for their further studies. Because as all of us know, we never had a scientific communication policy in this country. We never dreamt of the expansion of Indian media industry in this country. There are quite a lot of developments that happened, all of us know. In view of all these things, I think the future of Indian media industry, because there's a very serious question about the survival of newspapers or the magazines, and what will happen to the film industry, because all of us know in E&M, the entertainment and media industries, most of it is, even today, it is dependent upon the film industry for its revenue and survival. All of us, we know. Excuse me. So in spite of all these things, see, what will happen to different medium? See, unlike the West, I think the print format of a newspaper, it gradually disappeared, and everybody, they started depending upon the digital technologies, the emergence of the e-newspapers, the mobile became...
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Dr.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yeah. Welcome back.
Yeah, we are back. Yes, thank you. Yes, sir. We are back. Yeah.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Continue, sir. Sir, then we were discussing about the shifting from print to film. I think you were discussing about the television channels.
Yes, yes.
Yeah. Sir, tell me.
Yeah, see, as I was saying, the health of these channels depends primarily on the health of our economy as a whole.
Yeah.
So when the economy is in shambles, you cannot expect these dependents to be very healthy.
Okay.
So this will take a lot of time to come back to normal. In my view, at least a decade for our economy to limp back to normalcy. So during this decade of, in this decade of difficulties, it will be very, very worrisome for these channels, not only channels, all the industries, all job sectors, as I was saying.
Hmm.
It will be very difficult to sustain themselves and swim through.
Okay.
So I don't know how many will survive and how many will shut down, and I don't know.
So now I want you to sum up.
Yes.
The print, film industry, television, new media, digital, put it everything together.
Yes.
How do you foresee the future of Indian media industry in the coming decade?
Coming decade, of course, will be a very difficult decade for all these media. May it be cinema or print or news channels or any alternative platforms like digital media. Everybody will face difficulties, but I think we will come out of these difficulties, hopefully, because Indian is basically an argumentative Indian, as Amartya Sen called us. So we want to talk, we want to speak, we want to reach out, we want to communicate with each other. We cannot help it. We need to tell stories.
Okay.
So that is the basic instinct of a human being, and much more so of an Indian.
Okay.
So we will definitely want to keep talking, and we will need media to keep talking. Okay. So this media hopefully will not die, but we'll face a temporary difficult phase and then again come back, I think, or I hope, stronger than before.
Okay. So there are some questions from our friends. Shall we take
up please. Questions?
Yes. Murli Mohan Kati, he has a question for you.
Yes.
Similarly, like Kannada journalism content, like Kannada journalism content, limitations regarding social justice issues in Kannada cinema is also facing problem. How to come over this? How filmmaker can develop contemporary content and context? Murli Mohan Kati is from Baduku College. He has a question.
Yeah, I know Murli.
Yeah, yeah.
ಮುರುಳಿ ಅವರ ಇದಕ್ಕೆ ನಾನು ಕನ್ನಡದಲ್ಲೇ ಉತ್ತರ ಹೇಳಕ್ಕೆ ಇಷ್ಟಪಡ್ತೀನಿ. ಸಿ ಜರ್ನಲಿಸಮ್, ಈಗ ನಾನು ಹೇಳಿದ ಪ್ರಕಾರ 70-80 ದಶಕದಲ್ಲಿ ಒಂದು ಸಾಮಾಜಿಕವಾದ ಅರಿವು ಬರೋವರೆಗೂ ಕೂಡ ಇಡೀ ಭಾರತೀಯ ಪತ್ರಿಕೋದ್ಯಮಕ್ಕೆ ಸಾಮಾಜಿಕ ನ್ಯಾಯ ಅನ್ನೋ ಶಬ್ದನೇ ಹೊಸದು, ಅವ್ರಿಗೆ ಗೊತ್ತೇ ಇಲ್ಲ ಅದು. ಆದರೆ ಇಂಗ್ಲಿಷ್ ಪತ್ರಿಕೆಗಳನ್ನು ಬಿಡಿ, ಲ್ಯಾಂಗ್ವೇಜ್ ಪತ್ರಿಕೆಗಳಲ್ಲಿ ಮೊದಲ ಬಾರಿಗೆ ಒಂದು ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ಅವೇರ್ನೆಸ್ ಕಾಣಿಸೋದಕ್ಕೆ ಶುರುವಾಯಿತು. ಅಲ್ಲಿಂದ ಆಚೆಗೆ ಅವರು ಸಾಮಾಜಿಕ ನ್ಯಾಯದ ಕಲ್ಪನೆ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಗೊತ್ತಿದೆ, ಬಟ್ ಅದರ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಒಲವೇ ಅಂತ ಏನು ಹೇಳಕ್ಕಾಗಲ್ಲ. ಇನ್ನು ಸಿನಿಮಾಗಳ ಪ್ರಶ್ನೆ ಬಂದ್ರೆ, ಸಿನಿಮಾಗಳು ಬೇಸಿಕಲಿ ಎಂಟರ್ಟೈನ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಮೀಡಿಯಾ ಅನ್ನೋದನ್ನ ನಾವು ಮರಿಬಾರ್ದು. ಅವರು ಇಶ್ಯೂಗಳನ್ನ ಅಡ್ರೆಸ್ ಮಾಡೋದಕ್ಕೋಸ್ಕರ ಸಿನಿಮಾ ಮಾಡಲ್ಲ. ಅವು ಇಶ್ಯೂಗಳು ಇನ್ಕ್ಲೂಡ್ ಆಗ್ತವೆ. ಎಷ್ಟೋ ಜನ ಈಗಿನ ಸದ್ಯದ ಸಂದರ್ಭದಲ್ಲಿ ತಮಿಳು ಮತ್ತು ಮಲಯಾಳಂನಲ್ಲಿ ಸಾಮಾಜಿಕ ಇಶ್ಯೂಗಳನ್ನು ಇಟ್ಕೊಂಡು ಪಾಪ್ಯುಲರ್ ಆದ ಜನಪ್ರಿಯ ಸಿನಿಮಾಗಳನ್ನು ಮಾಡುವಂತ ಒಂದು ದೊಡ್ಡ ಟ್ರೆಂಡೇನೆ ಬಂದಿದೆ. ಕನ್ನಡದಲ್ಲಿ ಈಗ ಲಿಟ್ರರಿ ಸೋರ್ಸ್ ಗಳನ್ನ ಇಟ್ಕೊಂಡು ಸಿನಿಮಾ ಮಾಡುವಂತ ಒಂದು ಟ್ರೆಂಡ್ 70 ಮತ್ತು 80 ದಶಕದಲ್ಲಿ ಬಂತು. ಮತ್ ಈಗ ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ಅದು ತಗ್ಗಿದೆ, ಆದ್ರೆ ಮುಂದಕ್ಕೂ ಕೂಡ ಅದು ಬರಬಹುದು. ಬಟ್ ಅದೇನೆ ಮೇನ್ ಇನ್ಗ್ರೀಡಿಯಂಟ್ ಆಫ್ ಎ ಕಮರ್ಷಿಯಲ್ ಆಗುವಂತ ಒಂದು ದಿನ ಕನ್ನಡದಲ್ಲಿ ಸದ್ಯಕ್ಕೇನು ಬರ್ಲಿಕ್ಕಿಲ್ಲ. ಇಟ್ ವಿಲ್ ಟೇಕ್ ಟೈಮ್. ಜನನು ಕೂಡ ಅಂತ ಸಿನಿಮಾಗಳಿಗೆ ಒಲವನ್ನು ತೋರಿಸಿದ್ರೆ ಮಾತ್ರ ಅದು ಒಂದು ಟ್ರೆಂಡ್ ಆಗಿ ಪಿಕಪ್ ಆಗೋದಕ್ಕೆ ಸಾಧ್ಯ ಇದೆ.
ಸುಪರ್ಣ ನರೇಶ್ ಫ್ರಮ್ ಕ್ರೈಸ್ಟ್ ಯೂನಿವರ್ಸಿಟಿ.
ಓಕೆ.
ಗುಡ್ ಮಾರ್ನಿಂಗ್ ಸರ್, ದೇರ್ ಇಸ್ ಎ ಲಾಟ್ ಆಫ್ ಡಿಸ್ಕಷನ್ ರಿಗಾರ್ಡಿಂಗ್ ನ್ಯೂಸ್ ಪೇಪರ್ಸ್ but hardly any on magazines. Magazines are the most important platform for long form journalism and opinion building. What is the fate of magazine journalism?
We discussed this actually briefly during our discussions. So magazines will find it very hard to sustain themselves in the coming days, because digital media are becoming a very powerful alternative to magazines. Newspapers you cannot replace, but magazines are always replaceable, because they, you know, cater to certain kind of tastes and things like that, or certain kind of audience. Those audience are easily taken over by digital media. So it is difficult for magazines to sustain in the coming days. I don't think many magazines will survive.
Basically, Dr. Suparna Naresh, she is from the Christ University, and I think she teaches magazine journalism.
Question
for you. As a teacher of writing for magazines, does it mean journalism syllabus in future will no longer cover this aspect anymore? What happens to teachers like me?
No, journalism teachers will not be unemployed any time, in any time in the near future. I don't think so. If they are speaking of magazine journalism today, tomorrow they will speak of, you know, blog writing tomorrow. they may be teaching blog writing. So they won't be unemployed, but their area of expertise, message, or may alter a bit. But otherwise, they will be there. They will always be there. We will always need the teachers.
And you mean to say that teachers should be equipped to teach any other subjects? We have to equip ourselves.
Yes, teachers as well as journalists.
Yeah.
They have always, they should always be relevant. Yeah. Hello?
Yeah, tell me, sir.
Yeah. That's all. They should always keep updating themselves. Otherwise, they will cease to be journalists or teachers.
Okay. There is one question from Anjita.
Yeah.
Hi, sir. Post-COVID, 40 crore Indians are going to be in financial distress and extreme poverty, as you said. On the other hand, survivors may adopt to more technology and digital being from middle class, upper middle class and higher class. So, we can assume that digital divide and development divide may increase as government itself mandate digital adaptation to an extent for policy disbursement, online education, banking, etc. How are we going to deal with the inequality caused by technology and what can media do about it?
This is an important question, no doubt, but this divide has always been there, especially post-globalization. So we now know that 1% of Indian population holds 58% of the nation's wealth. So that divide is already there. Inequality is already there. So that is going to widen again, more and more in the coming days. She is absolutely right. What can media do? Keep talking about it. Draw attention of everybody, including citizens, including rulers, to this divide and suggest ways and means to overcome this. What to do? You should talk to experts and get expert opinions. You should hear your own views. You should, keep this issue alive continuously and constantly.
I think the internet connection is interfering. Yes. Audio. Audio.
Hello, can you hear me? Yeah.
Yes, sir. Now.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Did I answer the question? Was it audible throughout?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Okay.
There is one question from Adityanath Chattopadhyay from Birbhum, West Bengal.
Okay.
Sir, thanks for, he's a journalist, I think regularly every day he's with us. Sir, thanks for raising the heart-touching questions for farmers, uncountable distress.
Yeah.
I think profit-making system has forcefully installed all over the country. Please discuss on what issue at this moment we may recall. The ever greatest film director, late Sajit Ray, his film Be Ever Not Challenging by any film, that is Hirok Rajar Deshe, after that sex, violence and brutal activities are polluting common people. Am I correct?
No, I didn't get his question. What was the question?
Thanks for raising the heart-touching question for farmers.
I heard all that, but what is his question?
Profit-making system has forcefully installed all over the country. Please discuss on that issue. Profit-making.
Okay.
And he has referred to Satyajit Roy's film.
Okay, this profit-making tendency, what he calls it. See, this has multiplied many times in globalization period. Post-globalization, this is a phenomenon not only in India, it is the condition worldwide. See, everything becomes a commodity and every potential space is a market. Okay. So India is a market for Americans or Chinese. Mm. So likewise, the whole world has been converted into a market.
Okay.
So everything makes sense only if it brings in profit.
Mm.
So this has affected the way we think, the affected our cultures, it has affected everything. Mm.
So
we should only constantly and consciously combat this. There is no other way.
Mm.
Because we have not built safety nets against this onslaught of commercialization.
Mm.
We have not done it. We should have done that, but we have not done that. We don't even seem to think about or think along those lines, our rulers, I mean. Our governments have done nothing. But we should consciously, adapt ourselves to, we limit our means and we limit our wants.
Mm.
We should try to adopt a different kind of lifestyle.
Okay.
There is no other way. Yeah.
Chetan War is a research scholar from University of Mysore. ಕ್ವಶನ್ ಇನ್ ಕನ್ನಡ ಸರ್ ನನ್ನ ಪ್ರಶ್ನೆ ಚಿತ್ರ ನಿರ್ಮಾಪಕರಿಗೆ ಸದಭಿರುಚಿಯ ಚಿತ್ರಗಳನ್ನು ನಿರ್ಮಿಸಲು ಈವರೆಗೆ ಒಂದು ಭಯವಿದೆ ಒಪ್ತಾರೋ ಇಲ್ಲವೋ ಚಿತ್ರಮಂದಿರಗಳು ಸಿಗ್ತಾವೋ ಇಲ್ಲವೋ ಎಂಬ ಭಯವಿದೆ ಆದರೆ ಈಗ ಹೊಸದಾಗಿ ಚಿಗುರೊಡೆಯುತ್ತಿರುವ ಓಟಿಟಿ ಪ್ಲಾಟ್ಫಾರ್ಮ್ ನಿಂದ ಉತ್ತಮ ಚಿತ್ರಗಳು ಬರಲು ಅನುಕೂಲ ಆಗಬಹುದೇ
ಇಲ್ಲ ಅದು ಓಟಿಟಿ ಪ್ಲಾಟ್ಫಾರ್ಮ್ ಇಂದ ಅಷ್ಟೊಂದು ಆಸೆ ಇಟ್ಕೊಳಕಾಗಲ್ಲ ಯಾಕಂದ್ರೆ ಈಗ ಕನ್ನಡದಲ್ಲಿ ಹೋದ ವರ್ಷ ಸುಮಾರು 400 ಸಿನಿಮಾಗಳು ತಯಾರಾಗಿದ್ದಾವೆ ಈ ವರ್ಷ ಆಗಲ್ಲ ಈ ವರ್ಷ ಕೋವಿಡ್ ಇಂದಾಗಿ ಆಕ್ಟಿವಿಟಿ ಇಲ್ಲ ಬಟ್ ಹೋದ ವರ್ಷ 400 ಸಿನಿಮಾಗಳಾಗಿದ್ದಾವೆ ಅದರಲ್ಲಿ ಎಷ್ಟು ಸಿನಿಮಾಗಳು ಓಟಿಟಿ ಪ್ಲಾಟ್ಫಾರ್ಮ್ ಬರಕ್ ಸಾಧ್ಯ ಆಯ್ತು ಬಹುಶಃ 2-3 ಸಿನಿಮಾಗಳು ಅಷ್ಟೇ ಬರಕ್ಕಾಗೋದು ಅದಕ್ಕಿಂತ ಜಾಸ್ತಿ ಇಲ್ಲ ಅದು ಸಿನಿಮಾಗಳ ತರ ಅದು ಒಂದು ರೆಗ್ಯುಲರ್ ಅಶ್ಯೂರ್ಡ್ ಪ್ಲಾಟ್ಫಾರ್ಮ್ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಕ್ಕಾಗಲ್ಲ ಓಟಿಟಿ ಅನ್ನೋದು ಒನ್ ಸೈಡ್ ಇರುತ್ತೆ ಅದು ದಟ್ ಕೆನಾಟ್ ಬಿ ದ ಮೈನ್ ಔಟ್ಲೆಟ್ ಸಾಧ್ಯ ಇಲ್ಲ ಅದು ಸೊ ಈ ಸಿನಿಮಾಗಳ ಜನರಲ್ಲಿ ಈ ತರದ ಟೇಸ್ಟ್ ಇದೆ ಅಂತಂದ್ರೆ ಖಂಡಿತ ರಾಹುಲ್ ಹಲೋ
ಹೇಳಿ ಹೇಳಿ ಸರ್
ಸೊ ಓಟಿಟಿ ಅನ್ನೋದು ಒಂದು ಸಣ್ಣ ಆಲ್ಟರ್ನೇಟಿವ್ ಅಷ್ಟೇ ಅದು ದಟ್ ಕೆನಾಟ್ ಬಿ ದ ಮೈನ್ ಔಟ್ಲೆಟ್ ಸಾಧ್ಯನೇ ಇಲ್ಲ ಅದು ಸಿನಿಮಾ ನಿರ್ದೇಶಕರು ಮತ್ತು ನಿರ್ಮಾಪಕರು ಥಿಯೇಟರ್ಗಳು ಈ ಸರ್ಕ್ಯೂಟ್ ಮೇಲೇನೆ ಅವರು ಡಿಪೆಂಡ್ ಆಗ್ಬೇಕಾಗತ್ತೆ ಆಮೇಲೆ ಸಿನಿಮಾ ಜನಕ್ಕೆ ಇಷ್ಟ ಆದ್ರೆ ಸಿನಿಮಾ ಓಡುತ್ತೆ ಅದು ಅವ್ ಇಷ್ಟ ಆಗೋದಕ್ ಮುಂಚೆ ಅದ್ರ ಮಾರ್ಕೆಟಿಂಗ್ ಅದ್ರ ಅವ್ರನ್ನ ರೀಚ್ ಮಾಡಿಸೋದು ಅದ್ರ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಒಂದು ಅರಿವು ಕೊಡೋದು ಈ ಕೆಲಸನು ಅಂದ್ರೆ ಮಾರ್ಕೆಟಿಂಗ್ ಕೆಲಸನು ಕೂಡ ಮಾಡ್ಲೇಬೇಕಾಗತ್ತೆ ಸಣ್ಣ ಸಿನಿಮಾನೋ ದೊಡ್ಡ ಸಿನಿಮಾನೋ ಮಾಡ್ಲೇಬೇಕಾಗತ್ತೆ ಅಷ್ಟೆಲ್ಲ ಮಾಡಿ ಸಿನಿಮಾ ಇಷ್ಟ ಆದ್ರೆ ಅದು ಓಡುತ್ತೆ ಇಲ್ಲದೆ ಇದ್ರೆ ಕಷ್ಟನೇ ಓಟಿಟಿ ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ಆಲ್ಟರ್ನೇಟಿವ್ ಅಲ್ಲ
ಐ
ಡೋಂಟ್ ನೋ ಇಫ್ ಐ ಆನ್ಸರ್ ದಿಸ್
ಕ್ವೆಶ್ಚನ್ ಮೋರ್ ಕ್ವೆಶ್ಚನ್ ಫ್ರಮ್ ವಿನೋದ್ ಕುಮಾರ್ ಚವಾಣ್
ಓಕೆ
ಫ್ರಮ್ ಬ್ಯಾಂಗ್ಳೂರ್
ಸರ್
ಟುಡೇ ವಿ ಫೈಂಡ್ ನ್ಯೂಟ್ರಲ್ ಸ್ಟ್ಯಾಂಡ್ ಇನ್ ಮೀಡಿಯಾ So in films also we find the same trend. Where do we find professional ethics?
Alla avaru neutral stand andre he thinks neutral stand is a very negative thing. To an extent yes, it is not to me at least personally it's not advisable. I don't want to be I don't want to remain the neutral. I will have to take sides. I will have to take the side of justice. I will have to take the side of truth. I will have to do that. But at least neutrality to some extent is advisable because at least our older elder journalists thought that objectivity is a very positive thing and what they meant by objectivity was neutrality. But how can anybody remain neutral? It's not possible. Either you are on the side of the oppressor or the oppressed. You have to make a choice. If you don't make any choice, you are on the side of the oppressor. So absolutely there is no neutrality is possible.
Okay.
So if that includes the question of ethics, that is that.
Okay.
Yeah.
So we have one question from Vinayak Uniyal. How one can learn screenplay writing without joining any institute?
I didn't join any institute. I in fact I wrote a responsible in the writing.
Yeah.
How can one learn it? By studying films. That's all. Okay. By watching films and studying films. See, screenplay is basically the structure of cinema. The structure of the storytelling. It's not just the story.
Mm.
It's a structure to put it across. So structure we call screenplay. So when you see a film, forget the film and study its structure. That is the secret of screenplay.
So if you have any other things to say, you can finish, wind up, sir. The conclusion.
Yeah, we can wind up, but that's what I think. Journalists are also, you know, citizens of this country. They are also bound by, what do you say, the aspirations of enshrined in our constitution. We have a beautiful constitution. At least every journalist should read the preamble of the constitution at least once a day and pledge himself to stand by that. Not only a journalist, it applies to every citizen, but especially journalists, because they follow constitution, they will protect the constitution, by that they will protect the nation. That's all.
Okay. So shall we wind up, sir?
Yeah, sure, sure. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. It was an excellent session.
You have shared your
experience with all of us. And our internet ran some, there was some technical snag.
Yes.
So I request my colleague, Dr. Shailashree, Associate Professor of Department of Communication, to propose a vote of thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. On behalf of Department of Journalism and Mass Communication, I thank Sri N.S. Shankar for sharing his vast knowledge with us. Thank you, sir. I thank our chairman, Professor V.K. Ravi, sir, former Registrar, Bangalore University. I also thank my colleague, Dr. N. Sanjeev Raj, Associate Professor and Webinar Convener. I thank all the academicians, all the media experts, research scholars, and students. I thank one and all. Thank you.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you.
Thank you, dear friends. Tomorrow, the last day of our national webinar on the future of Indian media industry. Tomorrow morning by 11 o'clock, Mr. Vasuki, again a renowned journalist with a very vast experience, will be with us tomorrow, followed by the valedictory session. A valedictory session will be exactly by 12:30, and the former chairman of Prasara Bharati, Mr. Surya Prakash, will join us from Delhi, and we will be having our honorable vice chancellor, K.R. Venugopal, who will be presiding over the function, and we'll also have Mr. M.B. Jairam, the chairman emeritus of Public Relations Council of India, and we also have our registrar of Bangalore University, Srimati Jyoti, and a lot of dignitaries will join us. And I'm so sorry, today we had some technical snag. Yesterday we had a very big heavy rains in Bangalore city, and there are some connection issues so far as the internet is concerned. So I'm so sorry we couldn't connect you to the maximum extent. There were some connection issues. We were so sorry for that. So tomorrow again, I think tomorrow we will not have that much of problems, because of heavy rains. We have quite a lot of problems of electricity, our internet connections, and there are quite a lot of things that has happened yesterday. So tomorrow again, we'll get back to you, and kindly fill up your feedback forms. And Department of Communication, Bangalore University, we are planning to organize quite a lot of webinars from now on. Kindly participate, and we are very grateful for all of you, for your great support, for your encouragement, and please stay safe, be with us. Let all of us join to fight COVID-19 together. Stay safe. I wish you all the best. Thank you very much. Namaste.